This video is sponsored by Squarespace. You might have heard this bizarre property of spin 1/2 particles. If you rotate it by 360 degrees, it somehow doesn't return to its original state. Rather, you need 2 full revolutions, or 720 degrees. This sentence is technically correct, but I would also consider it a misconception, because unless you interpret the words rotate and state in the way it's intended, you might get the wrong picture of what's going on. So, what do these two words really mean in this context? Let's start with the word state. In classical mechanics, we want to determine the future trajectory of a particle. To do that, we need information like its current position, momentum, mass, and charge. You might also need something that is external and not directly related to the particle, like the gravitational field strength at the particle's current location, or electric or magnetic field strength. If we know all these, in principle, we should be able to determine the forces acting on the particle, and hence, the future evolution of the particle. That's the classical mechanics version. In non-relativistic quantum mechanics, we would like to do something similar. The difference being, there is no definite position or momentum. They have to be described by wave functions. And again, in principle, if we know all the information, we should be able to determine the future evolution of these wave functions. However, it turns out these are still not enough. We need an additional intrinsic quantity of the particle to predict the future evolution, and that extra quantity needed is the spin state. Similar to those wave functions, the spin state itself could also evolve with time. But the thing is that knowing how the particle physically moves doesn't necessarily tell you anything about the spin state. It really is a separate intrinsic quantity. This intrinsic quantity is what state meant in the sentence in the beginning. But how do we describe this state? Whenever we say a particle is spin s, by definition, the spin state is described by a 2s plus 1 dimensional complex vector. In the case of s equals 1/2, 2s plus 1 equals 2, and so a spin 1/2 particle is described by a 2-dimensional complex vector, say alpha beta. You might have seen it being described as alpha times spin up plus beta times spin down. Just that spin-up state is described by the vector 1,0, spin-down with vector 0,1. However, it will be very difficult to visualize a 2-dimensional complex vector. So for now, let's consider them being real first, and we generalize to complex numbers later. A real 2-dimensional vector is much easier to get a grasp of. Suppose the spin state is described by the vector A, and you take it to a measurement device. In general, it looks like 2 perpendicular axes on the space of spin states. When you take the measurement, the spin state immediately aligns with either one of the axes, and the probability of this vector A aligning with a particular axis is related to the angle theta made with the axis. Specifically, the probability is given by cosine squared theta. Another way to write cosine squared theta is to note that for a vector B lying on the axis, the dot product of A and B is the length of A times length of B times cos theta. Rearranging the equation gives cosine theta in terms of A and B, and we finally square it. The left-hand side is the probability we are after, and the right-hand side gives us a way to calculate it. This dot product expression allows us to generalize to complex vectors AB. We just need to think about what a dot product means for complex vectors. For real vectors, if you dot two of them, You simply multiply them component by component, and you add them up. Here it is AC plus BD. However, for complex vectors, instead of doing the same thing, we have a little change with alpha and beta complex conjugated. The reason for this is that if we dot the vector with itself, applying this formula gives alpha star times alpha plus beta star times beta. And this is the sum of the modulus squared. And this is always positive, except when both alpha and beta are zero. This is good because dotting a vector with itself is supposed to be the length squared, so it better be positive. So now we know how to compute the probability even if A and B are complex. An important consequence is that the length of the spin state A doesn't matter to the probability. Geometrically, the length of A doesn't affect theta, so probability won't change. But even from the perspective of the dot product, if you multiply A by any non-zero complex number, the factor Z will cancel out, leaving the probability unchanged. Because of this observation, we say that A and Z times A are physically equivalent. Sure, they are different spin states, but they produce physically indistinguishable results. In a similar vein, the length of B also doesn't matter. So it will be convenient to normalize the vectors such that they have length 1, then the formula could be easier without the denominator. So from now on, we are going to work on spin states with length squared 1. If we have the spin state being alpha beta, then the length squared of a complex vector is summing up the modulus squared, so we have this normalization condition. Let's call all these spin states satisfying the normalization condition to be normalized spin states, and we are going to focus on them. Okay, so in the original sentence, we now know that the word state means normalized spin state, but we still need the meaning of the word rotate. What does that really mean? As a bit of an aside, I did ask ChatGPT about this question, and it gave, well, something that looks technical and correct, but it called these matrices rotation operators, which is wrong. But ChatGPT might be good at something else. Understanding the intricacies of quantum mechanics can be daunting, but building a website doesn't have to be. This is honestly not too bad of a seg. But seriously, it is true that you can create a professional website without any coding experience. Even if you do have some coding experience, it is much easier to build a website when you have a wide range of customizable templates. Take this page on my website as an example. If I want to add another section, I can choose from lots of templates. And once I click on one of them, to customize it, you just have to click on the photo and replace it with a picture that you want to display. If you want to make it more advanced, like on my homepage, where I want to display channel statistics and the most recent video automatically, these are actually all done with code blocks in Squarespace. You can do that by clicking Code here, and you will be able to write your own code for this block. So, whether you code or not, Squarespace allows you to create professional websites. You can head over to squarespace.com/mathemaniac for a 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. Alright, let's go back to what it really means to rotate a particle. When we say rotate a particle, we are not referring to its physical motion. What we really mean is to do a pretend rotation on the normalized spin state, so that it becomes another normalized spin state. More specifically, if you have a rotation along a certain axis n, and the angle of rotation theta, I should give you something that I denote as D of R, which is going to be, in this case, a 2x2 complex matrix. This matrix can then be used to transform one normalized spin state to another. So when we say we rotate the spin state with axis n and angle theta, we are actually applying a matrix to it. And that matrix is the corresponding matrix of the 3D rotation we specified. As an explicit example, as we will see later why this is the case, a rotation along the z-axis by an angle pi corresponds to a matrix with negative I and I on the diagonal. So when I say, rotate the spin state through the z-axis by an angle of pi, what I really mean is, please multiply this matrix in front of the spin state. The new spin state is then negative I alpha, I beta. This transformation of spin states is a 180-degree rotation along the z-axis. Now, if we say this matrix corresponds to the 180-degree rotation, surely it has to behave like it. Let's say we consider three different rotations R1, R2, and R3, and their corresponding 2x2 matrices. Suppose we have the rotation R3, which has the same effect as doing R1 first, then R2. For example, if all these rotations are along the same axis, then R3 could be doing no rotation, which has the same effect as first rotating by 90 degrees, then a 270-degree rotation. With this relationship between the three rotations, we expect to see something similar in the matrices. The effect of applying D of R3 should be the same as first applying the matrix D of R1 to the spin states, then applying D of R2. So these D of R1, 2, 3 are not random. They have to fulfill this condition, which is fairly reasonable if we want to liken them to actual rotations. Another reasonable assumption is that if R is a rotation by 0 degrees, it makes sense to correspond it to the identity matrix, which doesn't change the spin states. If these two conditions are satisfied, then we say that D is a representation of the 3D rotations. It allows us to correspond rotations to matrices in a reasonable way. So that's it, right? We just need to find the representation, then we will know all the matrices. However, it turns out the only possibility is that all rotations get represented as the identity matrix. This is called the trivial representation, which is, well, not quite what we want. The reason is that these conditions are way too strict, particularly for the first condition. When you think a little bit more, it is possible to relax the condition. If we go back to the relation between R1, R2, and R3, instead of requiring these two spin states to be exactly the same, we just want them to be physically equivalent. That still respects the relation between R1, R2, and R3. Applying D of R3 would still have the same physical effect as applying D of R1, then D of R2. So we lost nothing here. We just have to remember what physically equivalent means. If two spin states are just multiples of each other, we call them physically equivalent, because the probabilities produced are the same. So if two spin states are physically equivalent, let's say we multiply the spin state on the left by r times e to the I theta to get the one on the right. If these two are both normalized, and because we have each modulus getting multiplied by r, we can rewrite the normalization condition as r squared times the original sum of modulus squared, being 1. If we compare these two normalization conditions, then all we can tell is r equals 1, but nothing about theta. In other words, if two normalized spin states are physically equivalent, they are related by a factor of e to the I theta, any theta. So when we require that these two spin states are physically equivalent, we mean that they could differ by a factor of e to the I theta. If we want that to hold for all alpha beta, the matrices themselves would also just differ by a factor of e to the I theta. This factor significantly weakens the original condition. And if we add the restriction that rotation by 0 degrees gets represented by the identity matrix, D is instead called a projective representation of the 3D rotations. We added the word projective to distinguish between the previous definition of representation. That's almost it. There is just a small wrinkle we need to smooth out. According to this definition, even if we have a nice projective representation, we can always just multiply by an arbitrary e to the I theta factor to get another legitimate projective representation. There isn't a problem physically, but if we have a rotation that is only slightly different from all three, it isn't unreasonable to want the representation to be very close to d of all three. If we allow an arbitrary factor, let's say a factor of I in front of d of all three, and we don't multiply anything for the other matrices, this is still a legitimate projective representation. But these two matrices would now not be close to each other anymore. Basically, the point is not wanting to break continuity. So apart from the original conditions for projective representations, we impose extra conditions to try and limit this arbitrariness in theta. For us, these conditions just imply the determinants of the matrices are 1. So when we say rotate a spin state, it means applying these d of r's to the spin state. To make these d of r's behave like rotations, we impose these reasonable conditions. These are just rules we need to obey when we try to find those corresponding matrices. But how do we actually find them? If we are just given these conditions, it's difficult to construct d of r because generally, we need Lie groups and Lie algebras, which is a story for another time. But if we only want 2x2 matrices, there is a very nice visual approach. Remember, these normalized spin states have the sum of modulus squared to be 1. If the sum of two squares is 1, it is generally a good idea to express them in terms of sines and cosines. I used theta over 2 instead of just theta for a reason, as we will see. These are moduli of complex numbers, and so they are non-negative. Because both sine and cosine are non-negative, we can just consider the range when theta over 2 is an acute angle. Equivalently, theta is between 0 and pi. This only tells us the moduli of the complex numbers, but there is no restriction on the argument. So we can write alpha and beta in this form. These cosines and sines are just the modulus of the complex numbers. So all the normalized spin states can be written like this. We also know that two normalized spin states are physically equivalent if they differ by a factor of e to the I psi. But multiplying e to the I psi will simply add psi to both of these arguments. Sure, these phis can change, but what doesn't change is the difference. The difference in the argument in the original spin state was phi 2 minus phi 1, and in the other state, it is still phi 2 minus phi 1. Let's call this difference phi. What this is saying is that as long as the two normalized states have the same theta and the same phi, the difference between the arguments, then they are physically equivalent. For the range of theta, we have discussed before that it is between 0 and pi, and for the range of phi, it will be from 0 to 2 pi. Knowing theta and phi, we can then plot a graph of the normalized spin states. We'll be plotting them on a sphere. We find a point on the sphere such that the angle made with the positive z-axis is theta. But there is a whole circle of points that also have this angle theta made with the positive z-axis. Treating this whole circle of points as a plane, we can use the usual polar angle on the 2D plane to specify which point on the circle. That polar angle is phi. So each point on the sphere having a particular value of theta and phi represents all the normalized states of this form. Theta appears in the modulus of the complex numbers, and phi is the difference between these two arguments. I think it's important to point out that phi is only the difference, and even after knowing what phi is, there are infinitely many possible values of phi1 and phi2. But as long as their difference remains the same, we have physically equivalent states. In other words, each point on the sphere represents infinitely many normalized spin states, but they are all physically equivalent. This way of visualizing the normalized spin states is called the Bloch sphere. And with this 3D visualization, whatever we have said about the projective representations could be taken quite literally as a rotation. But if we want to see which matrix a particular rotation, like this 180-degree rotation, corresponds to, then here is the procedure. Let's say we want to see the corresponding matrix for this rotation. We could just do it on the Bloch sphere directly. That would tell you how the spin states actually transform. To recover the corresponding matrix, as with any matrix, the first column is where 1, 0 goes, and the second column is where 0, 1 goes. But where are these spin states originally? The normalized spin states are written in this form. To represent the spin state 1, 0, we compare it with the modulus in the spin state and find that theta has to be 0. For the spin state 0, 1, similarly, we compare it with the modulus and find that theta would be pi. So if we plot them on the Bloch sphere, because the theta for 1, 0 is 0, 1, 0 is the point at the north pole. Similarly, 0, 1 would be at the south pole, because this is the only point with theta being pi. So perhaps now it makes sense why we wanted to call the 1, 0 state the spin-up state, and the 0, 1 state the spin-down state. After knowing where 1, 0 and 0, 1 are, when we want to find the corresponding matrix for a rotation, we can just focus on where the north and south poles go under this rotation. This green point was originally 1, 0. After locating where it is in terms of theta and phi, we know that the first column must look something like this. We don't know exactly what phi1 and phi2 would be, but we know the difference is phi. In a very similar way, we'd locate where 0,1 has gone with a new theta and a new phi, and we know that the second column is going to be like this. Again, we don't know exactly what phi'1 or phi'2 are, but we know the difference is phi prime. To nail down exactly what those phi1, phi2, phi'1, and phi'2 are, we can pick another random point and see where it goes. For example, where the spin state 1 over square root 2, 1 over square root 2 goes. This will not completely nail down these phis, but we are close. We also need that extra condition we discussed earlier on. Check that the determinant is 1. And finally, look for some continuity concerns. So we first locate where the north and south poles go, and this gives us an idea what to write down for the first and second columns of the matrix. To know exactly what those columns are, we can check another random point, ensure the determinant is 1, and continuity will take care of the rest. Let's see an example of rotating along the z-axis and see how this process can be done. This specific example is going to let us finally understand what this sentence really tries to convey. We want to figure out the corresponding matrix for a rotation along the z-axis. Both spin up and spin down states remain where they are, so the first column takes the form e to the I phi 1, 0, because all these spin states will be plotted as the north pole as well. In a similar way, the second column takes the form 0 e to the I phi 2, again, because spin states of this form will be plotted as the south pole. So the corresponding matrix would have to be diagonal, with phi 1, phi 2 yet to be found. The next step is to pick a random spin state and see how it transforms. Just to not get confused, I use theta prime for the spin states to make it different from the angle of rotation. Applying this matrix to the spin state, we get another normalized spin state. The first component is from multiplying by e to the I phi 1, and the second component is from multiplying by e to the I phi 2. Originally, the spin state would be plotted on the Bloch sphere, with the polar angle phi being phi prime 2 minus phi prime 1. The spin state after the transformation will be plotted with phi being phi prime 2 plus phi 2 minus phi prime 1 minus phi 1. Because we are supposed to be describing a rotation by theta, we expect phi to increase by theta under the transformation. The increase is phi 2 minus phi 1, and so phi 2 minus phi 1 is theta. This still doesn't nail down the exact values of phi 1 and phi 2, but we are getting closer. We know the difference is theta. Next, we want to use the condition that the determinant is 1. Because it is a diagonal matrix, that means the product of these two entries is 1. So we get e to the I phi 1 plus phi 2 equals 1. From this, we know the sum of phi 1 and phi 2 is a multiple of 2 pi. At this stage, we don't know the integer value k yet. But whatever k is, we have a system of equations that we can solve for phi 1 and phi 2. The solution is k pi plus or minus theta over 2. The really final thing to do is to determine a value of k. To do that, we use what I previously called continuity concern. We know that when theta is 0, we haven't done any rotation, so it should correspond to the identity matrix. So when theta is 0, phi 1 and phi 2 must be multiples of 2 pi, so that these diagonal entries are 1. By continuity, k pi would also be a multiple of 2 pi, because k pi is just the values of phi 1 and phi 2 when theta is 0. That implies the diagonal entries themselves are e to the plus or minus I theta over 2. So that's it. If we want to rotate through the z-axis by an angle theta, this is the corresponding matrix. And this is the spin a half part. If we substitute theta being 2 pi, the corresponding matrix turns out to be negative of the identity matrix, because the diagonal entries are e to the I pi, which is negative 1. This is very different from the case when theta is 0, which is just the identity matrix. This is what it really means for the particle to not go back to itself after 360-degree rotation. However, I do want to emphasize the following point and clear up what's happening. What we have shown is that the spin state is negated after a 360-degree rotation because the corresponding matrix just negates any spin state. However, even though these two spin states look very different, they only differ by a factor of negative 1, so they are physically equivalent spin states. That means you can't really tell the difference when you measure the spin states, they give exactly the same probabilities. This physical equivalence also makes sense when you use the block sphere visualization again. A 360-degree rotation makes any point return to its original place. The reason we end up with a different spin state is that each point represents infinitely many physically equivalent spin states. When you come back after the rotation, you could end up with any of these physically equivalent spin states. This is why I always emphasize in this sentence that the word state refers to just the spin state because physically nothing has changed. But there is a workaround. Even if these two are physically equivalent, there is still a way to detect this minus sign. The trick is that for a quantum spin half particle, we somehow put it in the superposition at different locations. Schematically, this state can be written as psi 1 plus psi 2, where psi 1 and psi 2 represent the particle states at different locations. You somehow only rotate the particle at the second location, and from what we have said, this state becomes negated. But now the state of the system is a superposition of psi 1 and negative psi 2, so the state of the system is now psi 1 minus psi 2. This state is physically different from the original psi 1 plus psi 2 state, and we can detect this difference, even though it is just a sign difference. This is possible because in some sense, we only rotated a part of the particle, but not the full particle. In practice, this rotation is done using a magnetic field, and the experiment is done using what's called neutron interferometry. Hopefully now you have a much better understanding of what this sentence really means. Something I haven't mentioned is that this specific projective representation we have gone through is related to many areas of maths. If we do the reverse, this map is almost exactly the Hopf vibration in topology. It also happens that these matrices correspond to unit quaternions, and this is how we can correspond quaternions to 3D rotations. If this video performs well, then the next video would be on how we can, in general, construct these projective representations using Lie groups and Lie algebras, which is a demonstration of how mathematicians approach a difficult problem. If you made it here, please consider subscribing with notifications on, liking, commenting, and sharing the video. And I will see you next time.